To get started, place a peg in the ground at either end of where you intend to run the fence, and then run a string line between the two points. Using a string line as a guide will ensure your posts are all in a straight line. With a measuring tape, mark out post hole centers with spray paint along your string line. It is important to be as accurate as possible with this, so we recommend measuring the rails before marking to ensure precise post hole positions. A standard panel uses three overlapping fence sheets, but in high wind zones, we recommend reducing the spacing to two sheets width to add structural strength. You are now ready to dig post holes in the marked positions. Digging your post holes can be done with an auger or by hand. You should aim to make your post holes 600 millimeters deep with a diameter of approximately 200 millimeters. With the post holes ready to go, you should now prepare your posts. At the end of each run, only a single post is required. However, at corner junctions, and if you intend to hang a gate from one end of the fence, a 50 by 50 post is supplied. This gives extra strength to the fence. If this is the case, using the tech screws provided, you should now screw the roll-formed single post and the 50 by 50 post together. You should also prepare the intermediate posts. Whereas end posts and corners are single posts, the intermediate posts are made up of two posts screwed together back to back into which the rails are inserted. Using the tech screws provided, screw the posts together in a zigzag pattern so they do not prevent the chute from sitting flush against the rail. We recommend erecting the two end posts and any corner posts first, as these can then be used as guides to ensure that the intermediate posts are in line and as straight as possible. If you are working alone, you'll need to brace the posts in position using clamps and timber, or when you are ready, have someone hold it steady for you for cementing in place. Before pouring the cement, make sure one side of the post is touching your string line. Use a level to ensure your end post is plumb. It is worth taking extra time to get these posts straight and accurately positioned, as they will determine the placement of the rest of your posts. When pouring the cement into the post hole, ensure that it is evenly distributed around the post for best results. If you are using quick-set cement, you will only have a couple of minutes to make final adjustments before the cement starts to go off. If the posts are moved beyond this amount of time, you risk having a loose post. Once your end posts are in place, allow 20 to 30 minutes for the quick-set cement to partially cure. When you have done this, lay the intermediate posts beside your post holes so they are all set to go. By now, the cement surrounding your end post should be partially cured. You now carefully reset your string line using the end posts as anchors to wind the string around. Try to avoid putting too much pressure on the posts, as the cement will not be totally cured yet. It's advisable to run the string line along the bottom of the posts, approximately 100 millimeters above the ground, as well as the top, approximately 100 millimeters down from the top of the post. Your top string line acts as a guide for you to get the post's height as uniform as possible. Continue to cement posts in position as before, ensuring that the centers between posts are as accurate as possible and the edge of your posts lightly touch the string line. Once all posts are in, allow the concrete to set overnight to ensure a solid bond. Begin by putting the bottom rail in position. The rails will slip inside the posts, but are designed to be a tight fit, so it may require some pressure to locate them inside the post profile. Once they are sitting inside the posts, position the rail at the desired height. Then use a level to ensure the rail is plumb before screwing through the post and rail to fasten together. You only require one screw at each end of the rail and on both sides of the fence. You are now ready to begin putting the panels in. Carefully place the sheets into the bottom rail, ensuring the first one is hard against the inside of the post. If you are working alone, it can be a good idea to use bungee cords or a pop rivet in the top of the sheets to hold them together while you fit the remaining sheet. Make sure the rivet is positioned at the top edge of the sheets so it will be concealed once the top rail goes on. Cap the top of the sheets with the top rail. Insert one end into the post first, then slowly lower the other end, ensuring that the top of the sheets do not catch. Once the top rail is in place and located in the correct position, screw off as with the bottom rail, and place the caps on top of the posts to finish off. Repeat steps for remaining panels. If you have a panel that requires a sheet to be cut down to fit, determine the width required by measuring from the inside of the post to the other side of the closest rib to the post. This will allow for an overlap of sheets. Take the sheet to be cut down and mark at each end, then use a straight edge to mark a guide for cutting. This can be cut with tin snips, a grinder, or a nibbler. Once cut to the correct size, brush away any metal swarf with a soft cloth, then place in the rail with the cut edge inside the post. If you need to cut a rail down, measure the required length and mark on the rail. Use a square to mark the cut on three sides. Use a hacksaw or tin snips to cut the rail. And file any burrs that may appear, and remove any swarf before installing.